Good afternoon. I am Abraham Michelen. I am an engineer working with IEEE GlobalSpec in Upper State, New York. And I am also a college professor teaching electronics and semiconductors and nanotechnology. We would like at IEEE GlobalSpec to start a series of videos for educational purposes or for design purposes also for engineers. So today I'm going to introduce a very basic filter, analog filter design and fabrication. This will be a very basic introduction without any a lot of mathematical equation or mathematical development. Just simply today I want to introduce filters in general, and so we will see what is the purpose of a filter and how we can design it, how we can build it from scratch. You can see here the content of this course. Basically, we're going to talk a little bit about the background of filters. Then we'll talk about the characteristic of filters. And finally, the most important part probably will be to talk about what type of filter we can build, passive filters or active filters. And finally, we're going to see how we can specify a filter. How we can, if you need a filter, what are the parameters, what are the specifications that you have to supply to the vendor in order to get the filter that you want. Let us start by defining what is a filter. A filter is an electronic filter. It's very similar to a filter used to filter water, for example, at your home. But in this case, our filter, will attenuate or will delete signals with certain frequencies. The most important part of this is that every signal has frequencies, and sometimes we want to delete a signal with certain frequencies. For example, sometimes you have a circuit and you don't want a signal with 1,000 hertz to be used in your circuit, so you should be able to attenuate it. So a filter can be used to remove or attenuate or alter a signal with certain frequency. And how we do this? Simply by reducing or deleting the amplitude of a signal, and also by changing the phase of the signal. For example, here you have a block diagram of a general filter system. It is simply an electronic circuit with certain characteristics. And the way that we use the circuit is simply we input a signal to the input of the filter or the input of the system, and hopefully we're going to get a different signal in the output. In this case, for example, that you see in front of you, suppose, for example, you have a good signal you want to use with frequency F1, as you can see in the picture in the left, and suppose also that you have noise that is mixed with the signal. This noise is not good for your system. And let's suppose that the noise has a frequency of F2. And you can see that both the signal, the good signal, and the noise, they have the same magnitude, or more or less the same magnitude. So you pass this mix through the filter, and in the output, you expect to have something similar to what you have in the picture in the right-hand side of the circuit. You can see that the unwanted signal, the noise, in this case F2, will be a little bit smaller. Hopefully it will be zero, but I'm showing you that it can be a little bit smaller respect to the good signal F1. And that is what we are going to be doing all along when we design systems, okay? Here you have a specific example, and this is an example that it is in the medical domain. Suppose, for example, you are in the doctor, you are taking an EKG, okay? EKG is a machine that will probe your heart or your body and will produce a signal that will indicate how good you are, how good your health. For example, in this picture you have here, the first diagram is the good signal that the EKG will produce. However, because these are devices which are practical devices, they have normally they carry noise, Noise is nothing more a signal, normally a higher frequency than the signal, the original signal, but it is not good because it noise will interfere with the what is supposed to, the EKG is supposed to produce. So suppose, for example, that the noise that we have is what we have in the second picture. It's a noise of 50 hertz, and the good noise, the good signal is 5 hertz, the one on the top. So when you use the device, the good signal and the noise will mix together. And this is what you see in picture in the figure number 3 from the top. Now you pass this mixture through the filter, and you expect, if your filter is well designed, if the filter is designed specifically to attenuate or destroy signals of 50 hertz, which is the noise, then we expect to have in the output of the device the signal that you see in the bottom. And you can see that the signal in the bottom is very close to the signal on the top, which is the good signal that you should get out from the device. So the filter will help the EKG device to produce the actual, to reproduce actually the actual oscillation of your heart. In order to understand how to design filters, analog electronic filters, it is very important that we know how we can represent signals, how signals in the electronics world are represented graphically in general, okay? So in general, we have two types of representation. One of them is the time domain, we call it, and the second type of representation, we call it a frequency domain. What you have in front of you is a representation of several types of signals. We have a sine wave, a square wave, a sawtooth, we have a triangular wave, et cetera. And these are represented in time domain. The time domain means, very simply, that the horizontal axis of the plot is time, and you can see, for example, the first one is a sine wave, and you can see that as time passes, as we move along time, the amplitude, the size of the signal goes up and down, and this is what we call a sine wave. So a time domain representation of a signal means that the horizontal axis is time, in second or millisecond or whatever is the unit that we have. The second type of representation, which is extremely important for the design of filters, is what we call frequency domain. In this case, the plot of the signal, the horizontal axis of the plot of the signal is in frequency, normally in hertz. And the vertical axis, which is the dependent axis, it can be the voltage of the signal, or the power of the signal, or it can be the gain of the signal, or in general we call it the amplitude. So frequency domain means that the signal is represented horizontally with frequency, and vertically will be the amplitude of the signal. And there is a very important reason why we do this. It happened that any electronic signal that is not DC, it contains many frequencies. It contains many frequencies. And for each one of the frequencies that the signal contains, we have a different amplitude. So if we plot the amplitude or the size of the signal as a function of the frequency, we're going to get a picture similar to the one that you see on top. The second picture you see there is the phase. You know, when you pass a signal from when you pass a signal through a circuit, not only the amplitude of the signal will change, but also the phase. And if you are familiar with this notion, you understand that the phase also is a function of frequency. So we have normally the frequency domain representation. Normally, we represent the amplitude of the signal as a function of frequency, and also the phase shift as a function of frequency as well. In the next slide, I have a typical filter. We're going to define some terms that normally we use in electronics, okay? You can see the block diagram. We have a filter, which is nothing more than a circuit. In this case, what you see is a black box, but normally we're going to see later what type of component it should be inside the box in order to produce a filter. We have a representation, the input voltage and the output voltage. Normally, if we want to represent the output, normally the output is the frequency domain representation. What you see in the drawing that you see there in the figure, we have the output of this filter as a function of frequency on the bottom. Normally, you can see that the amplitude it is not constant. Not always it's constant. So normally the amplitude normally will change. In this case, we have a system where the amplitude, when the frequency is very small, at zero, the amplitude is very high. And as we increase the frequency of the input signal, the output amplitude will change. Now, what type of plot we can do with filter? Well, we can plot many things. We can plot the output voltage as a function of frequency. Or we can plot the gain. The gain is nothing more than the ratio of the output voltage divided by the input voltage. This is the gain of the circuit. This is the gain of the filter. We can plot the gain versus the frequency. But most of the time, it is most important that to take the gain of this circuit and convert it into decibels. And the way to convert a ratio of output voltage divided by input voltage in decibels, you see it in this formula. You take 20, and you multiply it by the log, log base 10 of the gain, V output over V input. And this will give you the unit of decibels. If we don't use decibels, the unit of V output over V input will be nothing. It will be unitless. But normally we're going to use decibels, because it makes our life a little bit easier to define circuits, to manufacture them, and to understand how they behave. Now that we have how we can represent signals, from now on I'm going to use the frequency domain to represent the behavior of filters, okay? So let us start now by defining the type of filters. There are many types of filters, but what you see in front of you are the main four type of filters. The type of filter that you see in this slide are related to what type of frequency the filter will attenuate, or what type of frequency the filter will remove from the signal. And based on this, we have filter called low-pass filter, and these filters will block frequencies which are with high frequency. High-pass filters, it is the opposite. It's a filter that will block low-frequency signals and will allow the passage of high frequencies. And then we have a band-pass filter. And this filter is very popular because it is the filter that we use in most of our electronic devices, radios, TVs, etc. It is called the bandpass filter, and this filter will allow the passage of a range of frequencies. Say, for example, you will find a filter that will allow the passage of frequencies between 100 and 1000, so any other frequency will be removed, will be attenuated or removed. And then the filter that is opposite to the band pass is called the band stop. This filter allows the passage of all signals. That means that any signal that you put into the input of the filter, it will appear in the output, except for a small narrow band that will be attenuated. And that's what we call a band stop. What follows, the rest of this presentation, we're going to look at each one of these filters, and we're going to see how we can build circuit using components. In this slide, I'm going to show you the four type of filters, but we're going to look at them in different perspectives, okay? What you see in front of you right now is a depiction of the frequency domain of the four filters, but these are completely ideal filters. This filter, we cannot build them. It's impossible to build them. But this is what we expect to have, if we can, in a filter. The first one, you see that is the low-pass filter, which the frequency domain, it has a maximum from zero frequency to a particular frequency that we call the critical frequency, FC. And you can see that the output or the amplitude of this filter is very, very good or very high from zero to FC. But after FC, the output of the filter is zero. That means that this filter will only allow the passage of frequency between zero and the critical frequency, and then the output, if the frequency is bigger than FC, it will be zero. And the second one on the right, in the top top figure on the right, it is the high-pass filter. This is the opposite of the first one, where you have the output is zero from zero to a particular frequency that we call also the critical frequency. And then after the critical frequency, the output will be a normal output. It will be a maximum value or whatever the system will give you. Okay, so this is a high-pass filter. This allows the passage of signals with a high-pass filter, with a high frequency. Just before to continue, suppose, for example, that you have a signal and you want to remove from the signal any frequency bigger than 1,000, for example, hertz, 1,000 hertz. So you can use, for example, a low-pass filter with a critical frequency 1,000. So when this signal goes into the filter, you can see that any signal with a frequency bigger than 1,000, it will be zero. The third type of filter is, you see it in the left-hand side in the bottom row of this figure, it is the bandpass filter. You can see that you have zero output from zero to a particular frequency that we call F1, and then you have zero also from a particular frequency called F2 to infinity. And the only part that the filter will produce an output, you can see, is between F1 and F2. Later we're going to see that this range of frequency, F1 to F2, the whole range of frequency, we call it a band, the bandwidth of the filter. And then the last one is the band stop or notch filter, we call it as well. You can see that here we have two regions where the frequency, the output is good for the frequency between 0 and F1, and it's good from frequencies above F2. And then the output of this system, or this filter, between F1 and F2, it is zero. So this means that the filter will stop any frequency or will attenuate any frequencies between F1 and F2. So these are the ideal cases. If we can design a system, or if we can design, say, for example, a low-pass filter similar to with a frequency domain similar to the one you see in front of you, will be very lucky, but this is not, it is not possible. Because filters, they have regions where the voltage or the amplitude is high and regions where the amplitude is zero, we normally like to define these regions. And we talk about passband regions and stop band regions. A passband region is simply a region in any one of these filters that allow the output of the filter to have a magnitude, to have a very nice magnitude. A stop band is the region inside the filter where the output is zero or almost zero. For the low pass filter, you can see it in the picture here, the pass band is between zero and F critical. The stop band is after FC. For the high pass, the stop band is from zero to FC, and the pass band, it is from FC to infinity, if possible, okay? And the band pass, we have two stop bands, the lower part from zero to F1, and the upper part of the upper range, if you want, from F2 to infinity. And the pass band is between F1 and F2, which is what we call the passband or the bandwidth of the filter. And the same thing goes with the band stop filter, as you can see there. You can read here that these ideal filters, I am going to repeat this again, it is impossible to build. And one of the reasons, or the most important reason, I would say, there are other reasons as well, but the most important reason is that it is impossible for us to design a real circuit, a circuit built with component that will have a transition between the passband and the stop band to be instantaneous. You can see that we have a vertical line there. That means that as soon as you finish the stop band, the pass band, you go to the stop band at the very same frequency, and this is not possible. This, you cannot have instantaneous changes in any practical circuit. So we have to look at the filters that are more are closer to practical or to the real filter, and that is what we have in the next slide. Here you have the same type of filters. But I am drawing the transition between the passband and the stopband, not to be a vertical line, not to be instantaneous, but it has a slope. That means that there is an actual transition going from, for example, if you look at the low pass filter, there is a real transition going from the end of the passband until the start of the stop band. And this transition is nothing more than, it is represented by a slope line going from the maximum passband to the smaller stop band. I wanted to look at this and compare it with the old filter. So if you look back again here at the low pass filter, in the ideal case, you can see that the transition is a vertical line. In the what we call a real ideal filter, the transition is a line with a slope. It is very clear, it should be very clear, that if we make this line, this transition, with a steeper slope, that means that it has a more vertical approach, then this line will be approaching the ideal case. And that is what will be most of the time our design of filters is simply to try to make the transition, this line going from the pass band to the stop band, we want to make it as steep as possible. That means we want to have the larger the slope, the better. And you can see the same thing happened with a high pass. We have a slope in the transition. We have not a vertical line. And the same thing goes with the, you can see it with the band pass and the stop band filter as well. So most of the time, what we need to do, whenever we design a good filter, we are going to try very hard to see that these transitions they have a very high slope. This means that they are going to be very close to the ideal case. This, however, is not the real world. We cannot build filters like this, because filters are built with components, resistors, transistors, and things like this, and these devices, they are not perfect. But this is what you have in front of you, is simply what we want to achieve. In a real filter, a real filter is what we see in the next in the next slide. So here, for example, I am showing you some examples of a real low-pass filter. In this case, you can see that instead of having a straight line on the top, which is the band pass, normally an ideal case will be a straight line. Here, the band pass is a curve. It's like a parabola, okay? So it is not a straight, but it's going from the maximum value at the frequency equal to zero to a particular value when we go to the frequency, the critical frequency. And you can see that this line, it doesn't follow two straight lines like in the case of the ideal filter that we saw before. So this is the behavior of a real filter. we don't see straight lines at all, okay, in general, okay? Also, it is very important to define what is the frequency that will make the critical frequency division, okay? The critical frequency is this vertical line that you see, and we define the critical frequency as the frequency when the amplitude is 3 decibels, and I'm using decibels now, as we saw before, 3 decibels below the maximum value. And this is what we call the critical frequency. And the 3 decibels, it has a very important feature that we're going to look at it later on in this course. The next one, you can see the same thing. Here you have a high-pass filter. Look at the shape of the filter, the shape of the frequency domain. It is simply very close to a parabola again, okay? And the same thing goes with the 3 decibels. Here you have an example in this slide, an example of a band pass. You can see the band pass is not as beautiful as the frequency domain that we saw in the ideal case, but simply it's like a bell. Okay, the stop band is like a little parabola in both sides of the bandwidth, and then inside the bandwidth is like we have a little bit like a small bell. Okay. This, however, is not exactly the shape of frequency domain for all the filters. Unfortunately, a real filter looks like this. Look, I wanted to look at the picture in the left-hand side. This is the frequency domain of a real filter, an actual real low-pass filter. Built with components like resistors and inductors and capacitors and so forth and so on. I want to look at this very simply. You can see that the band pass, and let me go back here to what we call the band pass here. The band pass, which is the amplitude from zero for the low pass filter, of course, from zero to FC. I am representing it here in the ideal case like a straight line. However, in a real filter, it may happen that the band pass, it has oscillations. Suppose this is a voltage going from zero to FC, and this voltage doesn't behave with a constant value in this region, but it has oscillations. We call this a ripple. So normally, in some type of filters, you will have this ripple. You have to deal with it. There's no other way to do anything about it. And then the second region is the transition region. You can see that it's almost a straight line, but it's not a completely straight. You can see that it has a little change going from the pass band to the stop band. But it's almost a straight line. And we're going to look, as I said before, we're going to look at the slope for this when we design these filters. And finally, the stop band is not as beautiful as in this case. You see the stop band here is simply a straight line attached to the horizontal axis. In a real filter, we can have this. You can see that the stop band also has ripples. And these ripples, sometimes we have to live with them. If we don't like this ripple, we have to actually change our design. There are other designs that we can use to make these ripples smaller, or if possible, to make them to disappear. In the right-hand picture, you have the same thing for a bandpass filter. See, you have ripples in both the stop bands, in the right and the left. And the top, which is the bandwidth, it is not a straight line either. It has some activities. Okay. In this slide, I have only the definitions of what we talked before in the last slide. So here I will leave it for you, the user of this video, to look at the definition. We have a definition of pass band, stop band, pass band ripple, etc., etc. And this is what I just told you before, okay? And the second type of definition in this slide as well, we talk about the transition band with the slope line that we have there, which by the way we call it also a roll off. Okay, the slope we call it a roll off. Before to continue, I want to define something which is very important in filters. There is some definition that we call a pole, or the grade of the filter. A pole is nothing more than, normally, let me go back a little bit. Normally a filter can be built with resistors and capacitors, like you see here in this circuit here. If, for example, and this is for, by the way, is a low pass filter. If, for example, we use this filter precisely, a resistor and a capacitor, we get a low pass filter. Let me go back for a minute here, where the slope of this line will be 20 decibels per decade. That's very simple, all the time. 20 decibels per decade. A decade is nothing more than a distance between two points in logarithmic scale, where the second point is twice as big, is 10 times as big as the first one. So here we have, if you have one of this circuit, you have, we say we have a one pole filter, and the slope is 20 decibels per decade. If we put two of these together, we're going to see it at the very end of this presentation, if we put two of these together, then the slope will increase by 20 decibels more. So the slope will be 40 decibels per decade. That means it will be steeper. It will be very close. It goes closer and closer to the ideal case. Not all filters are built in the same way. So what we saw before, in the slide before, it doesn't apply necessarily to all the filters. And here you have in this slide some things that you have to consider when you design a filter. For example, not all the filters will have the same attributes. Not all the filters will have the same ripple, for example. Not all the filters will have the same slope. Not all the filters will have the same shape of the frequency domain. And as we saw before, a pole, I mean, one. If you use a filter with one circuit only, then the slope will be around 20 decibels per decade. A filter, a circuit, which is a filter, not only affects the amplitude, but also the phase, and so forth and so on. The roll-off is very important to remember. It's nothing more than the slope of the transition. The slope of the transition line. The bigger the slope, the closer is the filter to the ideal case. So that's why sometimes, if you need really a filter very close to the ideal case, then you can build filters with 2 or 4 or 6 or 10 or 50 poles. That means 50, you can build a circuit with a 50 circuits similar to the one that we saw before, one after the other. And this is something a little bit complicated, but it is possible to do. Okay, so these filters are it's important to look at the transition. The next slide, I'm showing you an example of a low-pass filter. This example is built, I built it with a very important computer program called MATLAB, or there is another equivalent called Scilab, which is especially good for designing any type of circuit, in particular filter. Here you have the plot of the frequency domain of a low-pass filter with 2, 4, 6, and 8 poles. And you can see that the transition, the more poles you have, the transition has a bigger slope. That means the transition, it is approaching to the left, closer and closer to the ideal case. So the more poles, the better. If that is what you want, of course. The next slide, here you have also a certain kind of definition that we are going to use in the next couple of slides. Normally, you know, like humans, we like to give names to everything. Okay, and depending on how the frequency domain behaves, what is the shape of the frequency domain. We have filters invented or created by greatest engineers or scientists for a particular purpose. And normally, we have many types, but I'm going to introduce the four most important type of filters. One filter is called the Butterworth, and the other one is Chebyshev. We have two types of Chebyshev. We have a filter called the elliptic filter or Kauer filter. And then we have another one called Bessel filter. And all these names are the names of scientists or engineers or people that invented this type of filters. For example, Butterworth was a British researcher. Over 100 years ago, he invented one of the most popular filters that we're going to see in a minute. Chebyshev is a Russian mathematician who also, more than 100 years ago, he created a filter called Chebyshev, two type actually. And then a German scientist called Wilhelm Kauer created also a filter called the elliptic filter or the Kauer filter. And finally, another German scientist called Frederick Bessel created what we call the Bessel filter. And I'm going to give you the shape of this filter so you have an idea of what type of filters you want to use. Here you have the four filters represented by a low-pass filter. The first one is the type of filter invented by Mr. Butterworth, and we call it the Butterworth filter. And you can see the attribute of this filter is that the frequency domain it doesn't have any ripples at all. It doesn't have oscillations. No oscillation at all. And you can see that in the pass band, you have almost a straight line on top. And the stop band also, you have almost a straight line after the critical frequency. This filter is very popular because in reality, this filter will give you exactly 20 decibels per decade. The slope will be 20 decibels per decade during the transition. The one in the right-hand side of the top picture is the Chebyshev type 1. And you can see that the difference between the Butterworth and the Chebyshev type 1 is simply that we have in the pass band there are oscillations. You see that there are. You can see that some changes in the voltage or in the amplitude in the top. In the pass band, in the stop band, it is the same as the Butterworth. Why we want to use a Butterworth or why we want to use a Chebyshev? Well, it happened that the Chebyshev filter, the slope of this filter, it is higher, it's bigger than the slope of the Butterworth. So if you want to eliminate a signal more clearly, you use a Chebyshev. And then you have in the bottom you have the Chebyshev type 2, which is basically the opposite of the Chebyshev type 1. The top amplitude is straight, is a straight line, but you have oscillations in the stop band. Again, the slope of this transition for this filter is higher than the one for the Butterworth. And finally, you can see in the last picture in the right-hand side and on the bottom, the elliptic filter. This filter has both oscillations or ripples in the pass band and in the stop band. The trade-off of this filter is that this is the best filter from the point of view of the slope of the roll-off. The transition is extremely high, even with one or two poles. And you can see it from the picture that the transition is almost vertical. Let us look very fast at the characteristic of each one of these filters. Okay, so I'm not going to go through all the description that you see in the slide, but you will have the chance to look at them at your leisure, okay? Here you have the first one, is a low-pass filter, Butterworth. You see, I have a filter of one pole or two poles, four poles, and six poles as well. You can see the different type of filter with different colors. And you can see that the one with six poles is the steeper. The transition is the steeper. And the one with one pole had the slope, the smallest slope. That means that it is almost 20 decibels per decade. So the one with six poles, the slope is actually 120 decibels per decade. And if you are familiar with the slopes in your math courses, you can see that this is a very steep line. It is almost a vertical line. The second type is a Chebyshev. As I said before, the Chebyshev has oscillation in the passband, but it has a much better transition than the Butterworth. To compare them, I want to look at this slide. Here you have I am drawing the comparison between a Chebyshev and a Butterworth filter. Okay, in each one of these pictures, the first one. You have a one pole for both the Chebyshev and the Butterworth. The second is four pole, then you have a six pole, and then you have eight poles. And I want you to look very carefully that at every one, with except for the first, at every one of these filters, the Chebyshev, it has a steeper transition band than the Butterworth. So that is why we use, if you need a filter that will be able to, you know, attenuate or remove a signal very fast, the Chebyshev sometimes is much better than the Butterworth. There are other trade-offs that I'm not going to mention here, probably in my second entry, but normally we have it in this way. The second one, I want to see another representation of a Butterworth, with a Chebyshev type 2. And you can see that with 2, 6, and 12 poles, what is the transition? For a Chebyshev, even though a Chebyshev with one pole is steeper than the Butterworth, with 12 poles, you see that the transition is almost vertical. So this is a very good type 2 filter, okay? Finally, the elliptic filter, it is probably from the point of view of the attenuation, from the point of view of the slope of the transition, this is the best. This is the best of all. And I'm going to show you something that will compare the three filters respect to the elliptic filter. This slide is simply a comparison. Suppose, for example, that we want to design an elliptic filter with six poles. Okay, that means six circuits, similar to the ones I show you at the beginning, okay? So this filter is shown in the right-hand side bottom picture. You can see this is what we want. We want to have a filter with a transition almost vertical. You see, this is one, you can see this is almost the ideal case. And we use, if we want to have a filter close to the ideal case, we use a six-pole elliptic filter. That's what you see in the right-hand side. Now, suppose you want to build the same type of filter, the same type of behavior, the same type of frequency domain using a Butterworth, well, you will need 36 poles. You need 36 of these circuits in order to achieve the same thing that you do with an elliptic with six. And if we use a Chebyshev, we need 12. So that's why the elliptic filter is the best filter from the point of view of attenuation, from the point of view of removing signals using very small amount of circuitry, very small amount of very small number of components. Okay. The next slide is just to show you a comparison between among the elliptic filter, the Chebyshev and the Butterworth for different poles. And you can see that at every moment the elliptic filter is the basically the best. Okay. Now, how we are going to build this circuit? This is important for engineers and for technicians and for people who want to make design. Well, let us see how we can actually use components to build these filters, as we're going to see in the next couple of slides. Okay, in order to build filters, because these are electronic filters, in this case analog, but our electronic filter, we need to use electronic components, okay? And based on the type of component that we use in building these circuits, we have we like to divide them into two types. One type is called the passive filters, and the other ones we call them active filters. You know, as human, we like to give names and make categories for everything. But in this case, it will make a lot of sense. So what is a passive filter? A passive filter is simply any filter that is built using a passive component. And if you are familiar with electronics, you know a passive component is any component that it does not amplify signals. It does not alter signals at all. So these passive components include resistors, capacitors, and inductors. Basically, that's what you have. Plus, of course, the power supplies and the connectors and so forth and so on. But normally, for filters, we talk about passive component, passive filters built with resistors, capacitors, or inductors. Okay, if the filter is built only with resistors and capacitors, we call this filter an RC network or an RC filter. If also we include inductors, then we call these filters RLC networks, RLC filters. Okay, the reason we want to distinguish between filters with inductors and filters without inductors, it is because the inductors are very bulky, and they are prone to catch electromagnetic waves. So we would like to avoid using inductors. However, if you are trying to design a filter with a very high frequency, you have no choice. You have to use inductors and capacitors and resistors. You have to use inductors anyway. But with active filters, we're going to see in a minute, we can avoid absolutely the use of components, okay? So let us see how we can build this filter using passive component. The first one that I'm going to show you is a low-pass filter. It's a passive low-pass filter. And you can see that if you want, if you have a very the simplest of all low-pass filter, passive filter, is the one that is the circuit that you see in the top, in the left corner of the slide. It is very simple. It has a resistor and a capacitor, and the capacitor is the output. You can see that the capacitor is the output. And you can see that you have the input voltage through the resistor and the output voltage through the capacitor. If we apply signals of different frequencies, then the output or the amplitude will look like the picture that you see in the right-hand side. The slope of this filter is 20 decibels per decade. It's a normal slope. Now, if you want to build a filter which is steeper, where the transition region or the roll-off has a bigger slope, then you can take two of these. Now you can see it in the circuit in the bottom row, in the left-hand side. You can see I can take two of this circuit, put them together in tandem or in series, and then we have a low-pass filter where the slope is twice as big as the one with the one one pole. And this is what you have in the picture you have in the right hand side of this filter. The more poles, the more of these units, the steeper is the circuit as well. The next one is a very simple pass band, okay? A high pass, I'm sorry. You can see that the difference between the high pass and the low pass when you build the circuit is simply the location of the capacitor and the resistor. In the low pass, you can see that the resistor is the output. In the high pass, the resistor is the input and the capacitor is the output. In the high pass, you have the resistor as the output and the capacitor as the input. And you can see in the right-hand side the drawing of the frequency domain for the amplitude and also for the phase. In the bottom figure, you have a second order. You have by putting two of these filters together. The next one is the drawing of a passband. A passband, you can understand now, it's nothing more than a combination of a low pass and a high pass. Okay, it's a simple combination, and you can see the block diagram that I have there. If I have a high pass filter with a critical frequency and a low pass filter with a critical frequency, and they are connected together, we are going to have the band pass filter that you see in the bottom. And also, you can see that the frequency domain is basically is what we have been doing, we have been seeing before. Okay, so you need a high pass filter and a low pass filter. And finally, the band stop. Normally, this is a special type of filter. Simply we build it in a special way. The way we do it is that we take a high pass filter and a low pass filter, and the signal, which is the input to the filter, it will be applied to both at the same time, to the high pass and to the low pass. And then the output of each one of this, the output of the high pass and the low pass, we pass it, the both output, we pass it through an adder. An adder is simply an electronic device that will take two signals and we add them together. And the output of this is what we call the notch filter. And you can see that the frequency domain is what you have in the right hand side. The second type of realization of filters is, as I said before, we have passive filters, as we saw before, and then we have also active filters. Active filters are nothing more than filters built using both passive components like resistors and capacitors, but also we use amplifiers. All these filters, they will have an amplifier. The reason to have an amplifier is two. We have two reasons, actually. First of all, if you have an amplifier in a circuit, you can have the output bigger than the input at any time you want. And sometimes that's what you want. You want to have a higher value in the output. But also, as you can see in this slide, we can avoid the use of inductors. We can actually use only capacitors and resistors, and also we can use smaller values of capacitors if we use the amplifiers. Why this is important? Because by using smaller values of capacitors and by not using inductors, which are very bulky, then we can build this circuit using small chips. Actually, we can build them in chips. We can build them as small as we want, and it will be much better than a bulky device. Going through this, here you have I will go through the same thing. Here you have the same type of filter that we saw before, but each one of these filters, you can see that this triangle is what we call an operational amplifier. And if you are probably you are familiar with this, so we have capacitors and resistors and an amplifier, and this will give you a filter with an output higher than the input, and also we can build this into a smaller chip. The circuit you have in the left is for one pole. The circuit that you have in the right is for a two pole. And this filter, you can see the second order filter, we call this a Schelling key filter. Schelling and these are two researchers, Schelling and Key, who actually invented this filter. The next one is the high pass, which is similar to the low pass, but the capacitor and the resistor are interchanged respect to the first one. Again, here you have the amplifier. It's an amplifier in feedback amplifier, and you have the output of the filter. You have it in the bottom. Again, the left hand side circuit is one pole, and the right hand circuit is two poles or second order. We have the next one is an active bandpass filter, and you can see that we let me go back here. The active passband, it is the same as before. We use a high pass filter and a low pass filter. But in between these two filters, we have an amplifier. And the amplifier will play the role of the feedback, will play the role of making the filter smaller, and so forth, and so on. Okay? So here you have a typical, what you see is a typical bandpass filter. And to show you how the frequency response is built using this filter, I have in the top figure here in this slide the behavior of the high pass. The second picture is the low pass frequency response, and the bottom is actually the whole thing altogether. I want to introduce, before to finish this presentation, something which is important, especially for bandpass filter. You know, a bandpass filter can have a very wide bandwidth. That means the a range of frequencies between F1 and F2 very large or very small. The way that we classify this filter is by defining something that we call the Q point, or the quality factor. And the quality factor is simply defined by this equation that you see over there, which is nothing more than the middle frequency of the filter, we call it F0, divided by the bandwidth, which is nothing more than the range of frequency between F1 and F2, which is F2 minus F1. If the bandwidth is very small, that means that you have a very thin, very highly selective filter. If the bandwidth is very small, then the filter that you will have, it will look very similar to the one to the frequency domain that you have in the right-hand side. If the bandwidth is not very small, then you will see a filter with a Q value very small, and then the frequency domain is nothing more than what you see in the right-hand side. Okay? Just to give you an idea of how we build these filters, here you have several type of filters, and you have the names over there. These are filters that engineers use all the time. The first one, we call it inverting bandpass filter. Then the second one is a very popular one also, multiple feedback with R3 resistor, multiple feedback without R3 resistors. And these are filters which are bandpass filters, which are we have been tested, and they are very, very popular, and they are very accurate. Finally, before we leave this presentation, I will show you some specification of filters that you should know if you are trying to buy a filter from a vendor. By the way, this specification, I took them from our website, Engineering 360, where you can go to Engineering 360 and you can search for a particular filter, and then you can specify any of these parameters, and the site, the search engine that we have, will give you exactly the filter that you are looking for. Normally, we have different types of specification. The general specs include the cutoff frequency, the bandwidth, the power dissipation, because normally these are chips, okay? So you have to consider the power dissipation, the supply voltage, the number of poles, etc., etc., okay? Then you should specify normally the application. The application is important because manufacturers build filters with certain characteristics to gear toward a particular application for audio, for automotive, for avionic, and so forth and so on, for the military, and so forth and so on. And then other specifications include the characteristics of the filter, what type of filter you want. And these are the four filters, the four type of filters that we saw before, Butterworth or Bessel or Chebyshev. And there are others called Gaussian filter or Legendre filter that they behave in a particular way. And then the type, what type of filter. Of course, this is important. You have to, normally you know what type of filter you want. You want a bandpass filter or a band reject filter or low pass filter or a high pass filter. So these are the specifications that are critical, actually. Now, if you are buying filters which are chips, integrated circuit, then normally it is very important for you to specify the package of the chip, because the package of the chip will tell you how many pins you have and where the pins are located. And here you have a list of packages which are standard in the industry. Each one of them, they have a name, and each one of them, they have certain number of pins, certain number of terminals, and so you will specify your filter package based on your application. And that's it for this video presentation. This is the first video that I'm going to produce through this Electronics 360 site. And I hope the next time I'm going to give you a presentation where we're going to learn how to design these filters, how to use mathematical equations, and how to use the software tools that are available for engineers and technicians to design these filters. Thank you very much.